നമസ്കാരം. നമസ്കാരം ടു ഓൾ. ആസ് പാർട്ട് ഓഫ് ദ ലൈവ് ഓൺ ഫേസ്ബുക്ക് ഡ്യൂറിംഗ് ദിസ് ടൈം ഓഫ് ഡിസ്ട്രസ് ഡ്യൂ ടു കൊറോണ, ഐ എം ഷുവർ ദർ ആർ ലോട്ട് ഓഫ് പീപ്പിൾ ഹു ആർ കൺസേൺഡ് അബൌട്ട് ഗിവിംഗ് ഫുഡ്, ടേക്കിംഗ് കെയർ ഓഫ് the security, making people physically calm. Most of the people are at home, maybe for very specific purposes we are out. Today also I had been shopping. Hyderabad is calm, not any rush is seen in the shops, but minimum required items are available. I could purchase fruits, vegetables, milk, water, whatever is essential commodities are available. I also have contact with most of the people with whom I am into contact. Today there was somebody who was stuck far away, 400 kilometers away from home. The person wanted to come back to her parent, and you know the travel becomes difficult, especially when there are restrictions on travel and the travel becomes a must. What to be done? So I got involved and then got some permission from the police department. You have to ask for specific permission and then the sanction can be given in such cases. That also has been obtained. So it's not that I know when in such a distress situations when somebody speaks about spirituality, probably who is coming on live, people will think this is only what I am doing. It's not. There are many other activities which I am doing, but this is also part of one of my activity which I do. I am sure Yeshudas can sing, probably Dr. TPS, me, I can give this mental strength to people, give them some, not entertainment, some educational aspect which probably could be related to my scriptures, what I have learned, what I have got from people. If somebody comes with a mathematics requirement to understand, probably I will also do that. I am doing live because somebody asked me to do it on live. I am specifically telling this because some people make some negative comments and that comes up as one of the thing, because people are not very keen on what is that they wanted to do and publicly they are not coming. But still I am happy Basi has asked, given specific answer to my question, what is that today we want. Yesterday also he had one question, whether Rupam is essential or without Rupam is there a mention in Bharatiya Shastra. I remember asking this question to my guru long back and he has given a very specific answer to this. He also was quoting Appaya Dikshitar. Appaya Dikshitar was a great spiritual man who gave an explanation. He was quoting, actually referring to Shankaracharya's concept of looking at God, right? So he says, Appaya Dikshitar says, this is what I learned from my guru, Brahmashri KPC Anjan Bhattadripad, who says, Rupam rupa vivarjitasya bhavato dhyayena yat kalpitam. Rupam rupa vivarjitasya bhavato dhyayena yat kalpitam. Bhagavan, you don't have a rupam. That's what yesterday exactly Basi asked. Do we have the concept of rupam? I said today I am going to answer that. That's why I am doing it now. Rupam rupa vivarjitasya bhavato dhyayena yat kalpitam. Yesterday I also mentioned we do puja with only sankalpa, right? We don't require material, it's only sankalpa. So rupam itself is sankalpa, but then what people have done to establish the sankalpa, people have given rupa to God, shape to God. Actually, we also pray that God doesn't have shape. But still we have given shape to God. Right? Why? That is because generally when there is a small children in KG level, we have to teach them what is elephant. We cannot show an elephant to teach. We give them the picture of a elephant and then tell them this is elephant, this is elephant, this is elephant. Not that small size which can be kept on a paper. But some sankalpa will come into the child, and when the real elephant comes in front of the child understands, oh, this is what I have learned and this is what this elephant is. Right? So sometime the rupam will help you to establish the shape. Though we know that it is not elephant, we will tell them this is elephant. I will show the picture of my father and then tell my son, this is my father, this is my father, this is my father. I know it is not my father, it is only father's picture. Right? But we will not tell this is father's picture. We say this is father. Picture itself is established as the rupam. Rupam rupa vivarjidasya bhavato dhyayena yat kalpitam. Basi's question was only on rupam. But Appaya Dikshitar extended it further. What is that for them? Stutya nirvajaniyata akila guru durikrita yanmaya. Stutyam, we praise Lord by using Lord of God and Goddesses, by explaining every bit of God, every aspect of God. Keep on explaining what God is. Stutya, stuti is given. Telling that eyes are beautiful, nose is beautiful, no hairstyle is beautiful, lot of abharanam is there, the pudava, the dress is very good, and etc., 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 etc. Is it required actually? Do God has got such things? It's only we made, or maybe artist Ravi Verma, the Raja Ravi Verma from Travancore Kingdom has given dress to God and then painted all the goddesses in such beautiful dress. But that is the sankalpa which we have, and with that sankalpa we are able to visualize God. Rupam rupa vivarjitasya bhavato dhyayena yat kalpitam stutya nirvajaniyata akila guru durikrita yanmaya. Vyaptitvam jaya vyaptitvam ja nirakritam bhagavate. God is there everywhere, but what is that we have done? We have kept them in some yat tirtha tirtha yatra adina. We have kept them in some small places like a temple and then told some places where we have to go for Tirtha Yatra, telling that God is there in Udupi, God is there in Mugambi, God is there in so and so places. And then we told that going there will give you more benefit. Vyaptittvam cha maya krita. Oh God, you have got such a vast place, every bit of this world you exist, and then still we tell them you have to go to these places for seeing God. Is it not contradiction? It's contradiction. How is it possible? That is possible, everywhere air is there, but air, to fill air we go to petrol pump, because that is where it is densified and kept. So through the pipe we get it into our tire. Because air is there everywhere, we cannot open the valve and then tell the air, go inside, it doesn't go. So some places it is densified and kept. So these sankalpa have to be understood in that style. Doshatrayam matkritam, these three doshas, what is that? Rupam rupa vivarjitasya bhavato dhyayena yat kalpitam stutya nirvajaniyata akila guru durikrita yanmaya. Vyaptitvam cha nirakritam bhagavato yat tirthayatra adina. All these are what? Chandavyam jagadisha tadvikalitam doshatrayam matkritam. All these are my dosha which I am doing. So understand, all these are sankalpa, and the shape is also sankalpa. I don't know how many of you have seen Peter Brook's Mahabharata. The Peter Brook's Mahabharata is 6 hours Mahabharata. I have seen it in open air theater. But previous to that, Peter Brooks have done it as a drama, which is much longer. I think the abridged version is 3 hours. the little expanded is 6 hours. The drama is much bigger than that. In that, if you look at Parashurama, Karna, Bhishma, and Bhima and all that, you know, they have a different shape. You have to see. Then only you will understand it is not Ramananda Sagar's concept what is there. So each artist, each person can visualize God, visualize these characters in their own style. Everybody has its freedom. So Rupam is there, but still we don't know which is that Rupam. We are only visualizing and conceptualizing it. So that is the answer to Basi's question, yesterday's question which was posted there. And today when I asked one specific questions to be asked, I am fortunate that Basi asked a few questions there, because something is seen there, right? The question number one, what do you say about yoga? I think the whole Ramana Maharshi's Upadesha Saram, we kept on repeating yoga. Also in Bhagavad Gita is a Yoga Shastra. The Bhagavad Gita has got Yoga Shastra. Without Yoga Shastra, there is no Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavad Gita has got fully Yoga Shastra only. That is why we call it as Karma Yoga, Bhakti Yoga, and the last chapter, Moksha Sannyasa Yoga. Only the first chapter is Vishadam. That is also considered as a yoga. So what is that I can talk about yoga other than this? Vishadam itself can be a yoga. What do you say about yoga means? I have to tell like this. Or is it what is meant by yoga as the common low level public who are using yoga for the yogasana? Is it that what is meaning? Then what do you say about yoga? Will it increase the power? Yeah, if you do physical exercise, your physical power will increase, if that is what is meant. If it is the other yoga, emotional, intellectual, spiritual, social, strength can be increased by doing the higher yoga, which is Ashtanga Yoga. I also remember mentioning about Mahatma Gandhi, who reached the first step of Yama. He could socially become powerful because he has got the highest yoga power in him, which is the non-violence. The first step of Ashtanga Yoga. Yama means non-violence. And the highest yoga is the spiritual yoga, which is Samadhi. Right? The real Samadhi, which today is called by many public lower level people as meditation. Right? So it is not a meditation. Samadhi is much higher. So we also mentioned that you can lead people up to Dharana level. After that, Dhyana and Samadhi, when you reach, that is the real yoga. So we must be very specific when we use word yoga. If it is the Ashtanga Yoga or the concept of yoga, it will help to control the mind. Definitely it will control the mind, because the whole thing is that. But then what I don't agree with Basi is, I think the life is to have such agree and disagree questions and answers, putting some questions which could make some sense, where we could make public to understand what is that which each of us think. So it's a beautiful mention by Basi again. Gita says controlling the mind like controlling the wind. I don't know whether Gita makes such a statement. Where I know, where Gita is mentioning such a small aspect of controlling a mind, is not told by, generally we consider Gita says means the Bhagavan's words are considered as Bhagavad Gita. That's why it is called Bhagavad Gita. Wherever Arjuna says it is not possible, cannot be considered as Bhagavad Gita. Arjuna is only asking doubt. Right? So Gita says controlling the mind like controlling the wind is not a correct statement, because it's Arjuna, as far as I know. If somewhere else the mention is there by Bhagavan, please correct me, or please make a comment so that I can understand that. I know in 6th chapter where Bhagavan is clarifying the doubt of Arjuna. What is the 6th chapter? After the Sannyasa Yogam is told, Arjuna still was not very clear. Actually, from Sannyasa Yogam, people should understand the yoga itself. He goes to Dhyana Yoga. That is also called Atma Samyamana Yoga. In Dhyana Yoga, the Atma Samyamana Yoga, the 6th chapter in Bhagavad Gita, I think it is to 33rd sloka, where Arjuna is asking a question to Krishna, because he says, Sugham va yadi va dukham sa yogi paramo mata. That is what Krishna says. What is sarvatra samam pashyadi yo Arjuna is, you can do that. You must be carefully doing it. My Atma and the Bhudatma is same. Understand that. Understanding that is the yogi's level. That is what exactly yoga is. That is what Krishna explains in the 32nd sloka. Once he explained that, then Arjuna got a doubt. So it is on 33rd sloka. He says, Yom yogastvaya prakta samyena madhusudhana yatasyaham napashyami chanjalatvat sthitam sthiram. It is not that easy. Steady mind is not easy. The situation is not there where I can stay stubborn. Chanjalam hi, 34th one. Chanjalam hi manah Krishna pramadhi balavadrudam talsyaham nigraham manye vayoriva sudushkaram vayoriva sudushkaram. I think this is where the Gita mention is being caught by people. Right? It is difficult. Like making wind or holding wind or controlling wind. It is very difficult. Being restless mind is very normal. But controlling the mind is like controlling the wind. Because manas itself is like a wave or the wind. That's what Arjuna says. It's a very practical, and because he is only in 6th chapter. Understood? When Arjuna is asking this question, Arjuna is in the 6th chapter. But I believe people like us, we have gone up to 18th chapter many number of times. So that should not be there. But having gone to 6th chapter, we should remember 6th chapter also, Arjuna asked a similar question. Therefore, the answer is immediately. Bhagavan gives answer perfectly, immediately. So he immediately, 35th sloka. I think people should remember the 35th sloka. What is that? Sri Bhagavan Vacha Asamshayam Mahabaho. Asamshayam Mahabaho. Undoubtedly, yes, my Arjuna, Mahabaho, you are so powerful. See, actually Krishna is trying to make fun of Arjuna by calling Mahabaho. See, in Bhagavad Gita, wherever Krishna is using very specific names for Arjuna, sometime he is making fun of calling him as, you are a very powerful man. Because Arjuna thought that controlling mind is like controlling wind. You should have good power, physical power. So that is why he used Mahabaho, the word there. Asamshayam Mahabaho Mano Dur Nigraham Jalam. It is very difficult to control your manas because you are a Mahabahu. Physical strength. No, you will not be able to do it with physical strength. That's what Lord Krishna says. But it is possible. How? So what is most famous in this set of slokas? Abhyasena dukaunteya vairagena jagrihyate. Yes, it is possible, Arjuna. How is it possible? Abhyasena dukaunteya. Keep practicing Kaundeya. That time Kaundeya word is used. Hey, my son, my Kundi Putra, my Bacha. Because he is not Mahabahu. Forget that you are Mahabahu, you have got power to control. No, it's not possible. Abhyasena tu Kaundeya Vairagena Jagrihyate. Is it possible? Yes. How? Vairagyam. Vairagyam. See, the whole concept of acharas which we have in our life, wherever we go to temple or yaga or yatna, most costliest things are put inside the havan, where inside the fire. And during that time, what is that priest is chanting? Vairagya siddhyartham samarpayami, vairagya siddhyartham samarpayami, vairagya siddhyartham samarpayami. Why am I putting this into fire? Thinking that I don't want this, I don't want this, I don't want this, I don't want this. Vairagyam is that. Right? So, without any attachment, vairagyam. It is not attachment, bondage. Bondage is attachment. Vairagyam is disowning. I don't want. With that thought process, I'm sure if you start doing it, asamshayam mahabaho mano dur nirgraham chalam abhyasena tu kaundeya vairagena jagrihyate, you will get it. You will be able to control your mind. So what is that we want? Don't think that I want to control your control my mind, I want to control my mind, I want to control my mind. It doesn't happen. Don't think about it. Don't keep on thinking I want to control, I want to control. That is not the way to control mind. Controlling mind is not like controlling the kite. What is controlling kite? Controlling kite is not closing it and keeping it. Allowing it to fly freely. Right? Allow it to fly. Allow the manas to go. Don't think about it. That's what is to be done. Okay? I hope the answer is very clear on the yoga concept. Then Basi again continued to ask, I have a question about transmigration of soul after death. Will the soul be reborn? We will get any reward as per our karma. Nitya Chaitanya Yadi is one of my guru. I am an Ekalavya disciple of him. Luckily, his two disciples are very close to me. My learning is through them or through the literature what he has given. When some disciple asked Nitya Chaitanya Yadi about after death effect, what will happen after death, though he also does Bhagavad Gita Swadhyayam by him is beautiful. If you read that, you will enjoy it. And his interpretations are mostly psychological, mostly close to human thinking and aspects. So I love such descriptions generally. And here, the question is almost the same. What will happen after death? Let us have some session after death. Why are we thinking about after death, what will happen? Is the answer, not mine. That's what Yadi answered. See, we have right to ask any question. I also have right to answer any question or reject any question. But I love academic questions. This is only an academic. It is not practically what will happen after birth, what will happen reborn. Nobody knows. Only Vyasa knows a little bit, and then he also mentioned that in the Bhagavad Gita in different places. Right? One of the place where he mentioned even before going to Moksha Sanyasa Yogam or Dhyana Yogam and all that, in the second chapter itself, Sankhya Yogam. Sankhya Yogam is more logical, more theoretical, more thought processes required to understand that. So in that itself, in the 13th sloka, there is a mention, Dehino asminyadha Dehe kaumaram yavanam jara tatha dehandara prapti dhirastastra na muhyati. The body goes to yavanam, kaumaram, yavanam, jara, and like dehandara prapti happens. And what will happen? We whatever we have gone through, we cannot think of going back to that. Similarly, this janma is over, we get a next janma. There is no going back to this janma again. So therefore, will the whole karma what we have done will carry forward, whether it is good or papa or no, not fully. But there is another normal proverb which we have: Nyan padi devam padi. Nyan padi devam padi. Half is mine, the half is devam. Most of the people mistake this concept of devam as God. No, devam is not God. Devam is purva janma kritam or sukritam or dushkritam. Right? My heritage, my tradition. That means what? Whatever I am today having, half is by me, half is by my father. Or if at all I have an earlier janma, from that janma. So not the whole thing will come to the next janma. A whole karma will not come as a reward or a punishment. But some portion of it will come. I have a beautiful poetry book called Life of Love, in which there is one poetry. I shall post it on Facebook here, the poetry, which is written in Delhi when 2007 to 2009. That's the time when I started writing English poems. Most of them are spiritually oriented. In one of the sloka is, arrow comes from shadow. For Lord Krishna, the Krishna gets his rebirth. In previous yuga, previous janma, he was Rama. That's what we all of us know. What he did during his Rama period has come back to him. That's why I kept his arrow from shadow. In previous janma, Rama gave an arrow from shadow. All of us know the Bali Sugriva tug of war, and Rama from the shadow gave an arrow. It came back to Krishna in the next janma. In one janma, Rama always had Lakshmana beside him. Whatever Rama did, Lakshmana had also a bit of suffering. So definitely that Lakshmana, who was an younger brother, took birth in Krishna's life as an elder brother called Balarama. And that Balarama kept on torturing, little bit of trouble all the time, annoying Krishna. So if one janma you annoy your younger brother, in next janma the elder brother, he will become your elder brother to torture you slightly. That's what it means. In one janma, Rama had a single wife. In the next janma, God only knows. So whatever in one janma we do, there is a reward. Krishna also explains this as in the 6th, 7th chapter and all that. Whatever steps you do towards reaching to yoga, sometime there could be a aberration and you may bound to stop because of external forces and all that. Then you will create your own trouble of relearning it from the beginning. Or maybe if you leave it at the right place because of some reason, probably you can continue from there. Depends on what intensity, how much intensity you have learned and all and all. Okay, so it is understood that whatever we do will have. But in my poetry, what I have written, for each one of us, today what we do will have a reflection on tomorrow. So each janma is a single day. Morning, Brahma will call us and then we are waking up. That waking up itself is one janma. Day is one life. Night, we are going back to Shiva, Lord Shiva, and then surrendering to him. Tomorrow morning we will wake up or not is not known. If Brahma calls, hey Dr. TPS, get up, get up, then I may get up. If he doesn't call me today night when I sleep, that is going to be my last sleep. That's only the guarantee which we have. So tomorrow what we are doing, we are getting another janma. But whatever tomorrow I am doing is because whatever I am thinking today, until now whatever I thought, until yesterday what I had, until today what I had, all these will become, not all of them, whatever I think, I have to keep for tomorrow will become part of my thought process. If not tomorrow, day after tomorrow. So it will keep coming. So in a micro level, every day is a life, which is a rebirth tomorrow. In a macro level, it can be considered as the Punarjanma. For a god, it is next to Yuga. For us, it is after death sometime. Right? Good enough? I think it's good enough. We can go on and on this. It's a beautiful topic. So wonderful. We could continue for longer, but let us have to have pause sometime to think that whether we will have second question, third question on the same thing for some clarification again. I love to see a lot of questions typing in. Okay. Otherwise, the live has no meaning. I could also record this and then post on to YouTube. But unless questions are there, live has no meaning. The life has no meaning. Questions were not there, Bhagavad Gita would not have been there. Arjuna would have stopped. Krishna would have stopped. Arjuna also would have stopped. The intensity of answering even for Krishna is when there are questions. So Basi continues with his question. Advaita means one, not two. Yeah, correct. Dvaita means two, Advaita is one. Then why there is multiplicity of gods? Why only one or two? Multiple gods are there. But all the gods together is one category. And another place is me, the me. Why I have doubt whether God is inside me or God is outside is my question. Why doubt? Yeah, doubt means, why doubt? Because there is a doubt. What is the doubt? Dvaitam is the doubt. You know, if I am very clear about everything, there is no doubt. I think that is why people don't ask questions. They are very clear. Second question is, I must be blind. I am not aware of anything, I have no question. If I have little bit of knowledge and then I don't know, I have a confusion, that is where question will come. A person who doesn't have confusion is in Dvaitavastha. No, Advaitavastha. Having full knowledge is also Advaitavastha. Having no knowledge is also Advaitavastha. Having doubt is what is Dvaitam. How is that? Assume I am traveling in little dark. That is why Ajnanam is considered as cataract. Ajnanam is like a Timiram, cataract. Things are not clear. I have a doubt whether this or this, with those or this. So Ajnanam is like that. So what has happened? When I am walking in the slight darkness, I have seen something which looks like a snake. What does it mean? It looks like a snake means it is not snake. Then why do I think it is snake? Because it looks like a snake. That avastha is called Dvaita avastha. So am I sure it is snake? No, I am not very sure. If I am very sure, what I would have done, either I would have ran back, escape. Or if I am brave, I will take a stick and then try to beat that and then kill. But then why am I not beating it? Why am I not running? I have a doubt only. I am not very clear. It could be a rope. I am mistaking it as a snake. So if it is a rope, if I run away, it will be shame. If I beat that, it will have no effect. And if somebody see that, you know, or I myself will feel ashamed of me because I mistook it. That avastha is called Dvaita avastha. I am not very clear. I have a doubt. I don't know whether to act or not to act. You understood? Either you need courage or you need knowledge. Courage and knowledge is not there. They have no doubt. They are in confusion. They don't know what is Dvaitam, what is Advaitam. So clarity is essential. That is why we say Ajnana Timirandasya Nananjana Shalakaya Chakshurunmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. Who is a guru? Guru is one who will apply kajal to your eyes. Ajnanatimirandasya. The ajnanam, not having knowledge, the blurred vision. Not having knowledge is not those people who don't want knowledge. Those who want knowledge, but there is some clarity, less clarity, so some clarification is required. Ajnanatimirandasya nananjana shalakaya. Jnanam is like the kajal which you apply. chakshurunmilidam yena. And that person who gives kajal, tasmai shri gurave namaha. So how do you understand, see the multiplicity of gods and this confusion, whether there are two, whether there are multiple, whether there is different temple and each place there is different god, different goddesses. All these problems will be there. You are having curiosity to learn, but nobody has guided you properly. When you reach into that knowledge level, you get into Advaitam. Until then, you have a confusion between the rope and the snake. You think that what is printed in the textbook, telling that this is elephant, you think that elephant is in the temple, in the textbook. The god is in the temple. The picture of elephant is in the textbook, therefore you think elephant is in the textbook. No. Until you see the elephant outside, until you realize God is inside, this confusion will be there, which needs some more time to understand, some more time to realize, some more practice, reaching into the good satsang. That is where we call it a satsang. Once you are in such a satsang, probably you will be able to get that knowledge. That is what all of us are trying to. That is where we need energy. That is where we need investment. That is where we need time to spend to talk to people. Right? That will come at the right time. Probably this is a time when we have to clarify such questions and doubts. So very, very beautiful questions by Basi. Very happy. Right? Now, Mani Unnithan has asked a question. Why is Arjuna not there in the discipline line of succession, even though the Bhagavad Gita was first recited to him? In what disciplinic line? Yeah, that is because Arjuna is not that, you know, the age of Arjuna and age of Krishna when Bhagavad Gita was happening. That's beautiful to know. If you look at the time scale, Arjuna was around 65. I think, yeah, 65 or so. And almost the same age was Krishna. It is not that guru-disciple level. Both lived together. Right? I have a beautiful posting onto my blog, on my blog. Biodata of Lord Krishna. When he has taken birth, when was his last day, biodata of Lord Krishna. I like people to look at it. Described the dates, when did Mahabharata war happened. Mahabharata war happened on 22nd November 1967, it started. And when 65 years was Krishna, right? So the 65 years, and 61 and a half years was the timeline of Arjuna and Krishna. Has to be understood very carefully. So, and it is not a disciple throughout. It took time for Arjuna to realize Krishna. And it is only during the Mahabharata war, the second chapter, he surrenders himself saying that I am your disciple. Yeah. I will listen to you from now onwards. Correct. But still, that was not a total surrender. It took another 16 chapters to drag Arjuna by Krishna to look at different styles, including the Purna Ghora avataram. We have to call it as Ghora avataram. Right? The Vishwarupam. Showing that, then Arjuna got a little bhakti. So it is not like guru and shishya sort of a relation. Bhagavan himself telling Arjuna is not like a normal disciple. right? So it is not that style of a Guru Shishya Parampara. That style of making Arjuna to do whatever Guru says. So it's entirely different. They have different relationship. They have relationship of so close friendship. That is why Arjuna and Krishna, they keep calling each other in different names. Partha, Kaundeya. Arjuna is loved by Krishna not because Arjuna is a person like a Guru Shishya Parambara. Because you are my Kundi's son, I love you. Because you are Bharata Vamsha, one of the person, strong person in the Bharata Vamsha, I love you. There are different reasons for Krishna to love Arjuna. Right? So that is, for a Guru and a Shishya, the relationship is very clear. That is the only way they have to be understood clearly, and then that is how it should run. Right? Today we had a discussion. Pradeep Nambiar also wanted me to talk about the energy concept. See, there are yesterday we had a small mention about our horoscope. Taking birth is like putting you inside a car, and then you are supposed to drive. Understood? And you have a beautiful road. The road is your vastu, the environment. But a beautiful road like a airport road and a wonderful car, fully automatic, will not help you unless you have the skill to drive. That skill to drive will happen only if you have attitude. So if you want to perform, you need to have three qualities. One is you need to have an attitude. Second, you need to have a skill. And third one, you need a good environment. That environment is your road. That attitude is filled with your horoscope. That's how your basic character is. What is the karma which we do, which will give you the karma which we do, will give you skill. So it needs a practice, it needs a development of skill, it needs gaining knowledge for you to perform. That needs an environment support. Environment is not here, I will hunt for my environment. So vastu is not the house where you stay. This is where people mistook. If I construct a house in my native, do I have a problem? If I am staying in Dubai, I lost a job because I constructed a house in my native. Stupid. No. Just because you own the land, just because the shape of your land is not as per vastu, these are all stupid, misinterpreted vastu which we understand today because of the bad vastu experts around us. I am Payyanur Keshavara Achari's disciple on Vastu Vidya. He has written nearly 32 books. Ganita Ratnakaram was the first book which by mistake I stepped upon for started reading Vastu in early 1990s. It's almost 20-30 years back. I remember when I met him, he blessed me and then said, I understood what is the concept inside what he has written. The energy concept is very, very essential. The energy is not just because you own a land, just because the rent is paid by you, or you are the owner and somebody else is staying, you get the rent. No. Vastu Purusha doesn't look at the survey number, plot number, yard number, road number and all that, and then reach and to come to your house to disturb. The environment around which and the center you have a house. How big? A large land. Inside that a small house. Or a big land equivalent to half acre say, and there are no other houses around. If you have a house and then you stay there, you are along with the environment. Otherwise, you are in an apartment, you are in an array of houses in a colony, their vastu doesn't affect. Maybe your neighbor will affect you more than the grahas and the vastu purusha. Understood? So the energy concept is very clear. There is a concept of energy. There is a life force energy. There is an earth energy. There is a grid line which passes around the earth as drainage of bad and good energies. There is a grid around earth. That's called the grid line. Right? It's called the bioenergy. There is a biorhythm around us which influences each one of us. That can create problems and that can also become blessing. You can also create good energy with your family and friends and then good satsang along with you. Having good society, having good social environment, having a good manas, that has to come basically from you. Traditionally also you get a lot of bad and good habits. Assume that there is a family who keep on talking about bad health, bad health, bad health, bad health, bad health. Definitely you will only talk about bad health in your life. Right? There may be another family who doesn't concern about these small problems. It all depends on your hierarchy and hereditary, what you got from your grandparents and parents and such. So you know how to ignore, you know how to consider it very serious. Only serious things have to be considered seriously. What is required is a refinement. What is required is a peaceful life. What is required is a neat, disciplined life. But then some people will ask, neat, disciplined is important or happiness is important? A house have to be neat enough to be healthy and untidy enough to be happy. Both has to be there. Balancing, that is must. Some people cannot live without cleaning. Some people cannot stop cleaning. Some people never clean their houses also. There is a balance required in life, right? All that, your skill, development of life around us. And we have a right time. Actually, this is a beautiful time. The other day I heard Kavalam Sri Kumar, a beautiful poetry, reciting. He says, this is the right time for you and you are at home. Clean your house first. There are lot of dress which you may not use, which is not clean, which is not ironed and kept properly. You have sufficient time now, but you don't have the practice of doing things. Still, you depend on somebody else. There are books to be kept in order. There are books to be read, finishing. Read. Invest your time for better purposes. Don't be 24 hours on TV counting the number. We have anyway nothing to do with that. Right? Yes, we have to be concerned. We are a social being, but invest some time on that. But invest some time in making you also to prepare to become stronger. Any day, one of these days, we will love Krishna Rama Govinda. That is not important. But as long as we give, let us live a little happy. Understand what is life. Understand little scriptures which were given by... See, why are we investing our time on all these? Because all these were given by our great Guru Parampara, which were all very, very precious. If it is not precious, why people kept for this long? It's all thousands and thousands of years. We never kept anything which is not required in our house. Similarly, no culture, no religion in the world will keep anything in with them if it is quite useless. If our tradition has kept something, that means it has got something useful for human being. That is Shastram. What is Shastram? Sathat anubhavairdrishto na gurudo na gurudarshidaha lokanam upakaraya yatat sarvam pradarshitam. What is told by science people is not what is science. What can be proved and seen is not what is science. Right? Every day we read some stories about corona. Some graph is made by one great university in America which says corona is going to raise in next 1 month. Then next university, another fellow says these are all wrong because of 21 days of disciplined life, corona will die. Both are published by research scholars and great scientists only. Which is to be believed? Lokanam upakaraya etat sarvam pradarshitam. What is useful for human being is what is science. That's what we accept it. Right? And I'm seeing one question from, I don't know who is this. I'm seeing one question from again Basi. Yeah, and before that Unnithan's question, I think I have taken. The Basi has asked. I think we should have a one-one dialogue with Basi. Only Basi has questions, right? Chinmayanandji said that there is intellect, mind and vasana, and as per vasanas we are reborn. Krishna said and fed up. Fed up has got a different meaning anyway. Okay. By wife and maybe be five and husbands, wife and husbands maybe. And Panchali, she aspired to become husbands of, I don't know what Chinmayanandaji told. I think you should ask Chinmayanandaji only, or re-listen to that to understand better. My fortune or unfortune is I have not heard too much on these people. My learning is from not famous people, right? My learning is from learned people, right? I am not saying Chinmayanandaji is not learned, but he must have, by joke also he makes so many statements. One few of his lectures in 1970s and the earlier in the American disciples, if you listen to them, more than Bhagavad Gita classes, probably there could be fun to entertain the people who are on in America. That is how he could catch attention of lot of Westerners. So those lifestyle of such people have been made fun of for attracting and then connecting to some of the slokas. Probably in our context, in our discussions, this may become unfit sometime. That's what, when I listened to some of them, I felt. Okay, so this could be some such mention about husband, wife and such things and all that, right? Dhanundari and strengthened person. It correct. So many things are asked and then I think I am not able to read them 100%. And then last, there is a question which is correct, which needs some more time to understand and study and listen to that clipping which you have listened. You can send that personally so that I could get some clarifications from you before getting into that, right? I wish some very specific questions, not mentioning somebody, what somebody said in some point of time, because I have not listened, I cannot comment them, right? I just mentioned a few generic comment which may be appropriate or not appropriate also at this context. A Bengali poet asked, again quoting some Bengali poet. I don't know what Bengali poet spoke on what context. I think Basi should understand when you quote, probably you could send a personal email. My email is available. My WhatsApp is available. Go to my website, look at it, send a WhatsApp so that send that clipping, that poet, what he wrote in poetry. I don't understand Bengali, so I will have to look at English translation for that. Every happens as per fate. Why should I cannot Kali Mata? Why should I don't understand this English. Chanting the God's name will change my destiny. I don't know whether you cannot just by chanting the goddess name, my destiny will change. I don't know. I told you it is not. It's only sankalpa. It's only understanding. It is only creating your own world around you with a good satkarma and karma. Right? It also depends on your attitude. It also depends on what paramparyam, what has come to you from your tradition. It also depends on the satsang. It also depends on the environment and attitude. So many things. There is a saying that you keep on chanting Devi's or maybe God or Goddess's names, but your thought process can be something else. So by repeating somebody his names, doesn't, I don't know whether it make some changes. These are like LKG children repeating slok, repeating Tingle Tingle Little Star without even knowing who has written Tingle Tingle Little Star. So I think these are which cannot be answered just like this. That's only what I'm saying. Okay. I wish somebody else have got some questions who are you require some answers, and such questions can be either posted to my WhatsApp or onto this Facebook. Otherwise, I think if it is only a personal interaction between me and Basi, I think we will do it personally. I think the live has no meaning when there are no questions very seriously. I am so happy that Unnithan asked a question, and Basi has a lot of questions, but some of the questions are so vague, probably will have problem in commenting. Got it. So let me see whether some reaction comes onto my WhatsApp based on that. Probably I will appear tomorrow. Otherwise, this will be my last session. I think we have 5 more minutes. If somebody has got some very specific comments, do I have to continue? There are few people on live. I'm seeing a lot of people are seeing. Sometimes it doesn't worth sometime. Yeah, probably this man is not talking something very serious, which doesn't require. That also is possible. So why should I ask him some questions? It doesn't worth. That also can happen. So I'm not demanding questions, but if there is something, probably if you could continue. Vijesh Nair, does Vastu Shastra really have any impact on us, or is it just psychological satisfaction? No, Vastu is a very specific Shastra which talks about the energy in earth. The earth has got an energy, and it has got a specific grid lines. It has got something to do with the surroundings, which can create some energy levels by changing some, but not too much of demolition. But yes, it is based on the place and your construction style. But it always can be manipulated. But that is applicable only when you have a larger land, and in which your house is constructed like there is a specific measurement, like 20 cents and more. Probably you are constructing a 1,000 square feet multi-storied, maybe one or two storied one for your own, then it is possible. But this has to be refined. The traditional Vastu, which are explained, also tells that you cannot have different wood for one for chalk out, one for shutter. But that is written on a time when you don't have the seasoning of wood is possible. And it says that you cannot have this tree in this size center, this side of your house you cannot plant this tree. The variety of trees were mentioned were what to be planted. They are all mentioned because normally thatched roof used to be of tile, so if something falls, it could create a problem, right? So all that Shastra, including Vastu, specifically Vastu, Stala Kalam. Stalam is place, Kalam is time. The place and time determines whether it is applicable or not. It is not a blind Shastram which is applicable everywhere, every time. No. This is timely when and where it can be applied. Has to be very specifically prescribed. See, for example, the south wind is more in Kerala. So it was told the south side you cannot have a kitchen. But exactly opposite is what is followed in the east side of India. Kerala is in the west side of India. So wind direction is different. So it is not a direction which describes Vastu. It is the basic local place in which you have to do your own experiment to understand. I mean, what is written as Vastu in Kerala cannot be followed in Tamil Nadu. What is followed in Tamil Nadu cannot be followed in Kashmir. So basically, person has to be at that place where house is getting constructed, test it thoroughly, and then understand. If you have not seen the movie Perundachan in Malayalam, you look at how Perundachan is identifying the wind direction to stop wind for the light to lit properly. Got it? So he knows directions. So direction is more important. Understanding the place, the taste of the mud is important to understand who can construct a house. And traditional Vastu textbook, the measurements are also different for different category of people. A Brahmin should have a puja room But same puja room is prescribed for a Vaishya or Shudra who is not into actual doing puja per se. Because a pujari is doing puja, he need a big puja room. If somebody is not doing puja but he is only lighting a lamp, he need less one. Specifications are different. So it depends on for whom you are constructing house. So the assume that I am a businessman, or maybe I am a person who is in the Kshatriya who has got lot of visitors. Probably I need a bigger visitor room. If I am not, I am only a Vaishya where my business storage is room has to be bigger. So it all depends on what category of people you are. Vastu is a great Shastra which needs to be understood for whom I am constructing the house. Right. Again, Bhasi has a question, where am I based? I am not based, I am a baseless man. But temporarily, I will stay in Hyderabad. My hometown is in Kerala. So I am there in Kannur and Thrissur. My wife is from Thrissur, I am from Kannur. I keep traveling most of the time. Last one year, that means 2018-19, I was in US for 6 months. That's where I taught Bhagavad Gita and Sunday discussions and dialogues, Lalita Sahasranama meaning explanations, and you can see all of my activity. Where I am will be known from my YouTube. It also posts where at different places I used to be. Last month I was in Thiruvannamalai. After that I was in Kanyakumari district for some time, then in Thiruvananthapuram. Now maybe 21 days, probably a little longer, I will be in Hyderabad. Hastarega and Jyotisham are scientific, or is it hocus pocus? I don't know. See, the energy with which we are describing the thought process, the life force energy, all that environment energy have got an influence in creating these lines. That lines are created based on my thoughts. So some of the interpretations of my thoughts, which are basically non-outside or internally understood, can be read from the Hastarega. Therefore, that is scientific. Jyotisham, we already explained, again same question asked. Astrology is what is Jyotisham? So predictions need not be. I recommend you to go through my astrology classes which are there on YouTube. Okay. I stay in a ready-made flat. How can I make, because today none of us have got such sort of a specification, and for Vastu, for any apartment or flat, there is no Vastu specifications at all. If traditional Vastu is what is being followed, your bathroom has to be too far from your house. That means your bathroom has to be in somebody's apartment. So these are all stupid. Vastu doesn't apply for any apartment. Multi-storied houses are all discarded from the rules of apartments. So namaskaram to each one of you. This is 5 o'clock crossed. I think for today this is good enough. Let us see if there are some very specific, very serious questions which I also love to answer, where I have got very specific comments to be made. See you tomorrow on live again. Thank you. God bless you.